Excuse us, we're having some technical difficulties. Would you all please stand and join us for the next tune? we're singing Here I Am to Worship, which is in your bulletin. At the end, there's a chorus return, so when you hit the end of the tune, go back to the beginning. Thank you.
Sometimes forget that being a child was a special time in our lives and may devalue that time.
For example, the Apostle Paul wrote, "When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways." As adults, we can lose the sense of awe and wonder, that readiness to listen, that willingness to be loved and to love,
It's good to see all of you here as we gather for worship on this day at First Presbyterian Church. Would ask that you would take a friendship register that you would find in the pew and that you would pass it, fill it out and pass it to your neighbor so that we might have a record of your attendance today. And if you're a first-time visitor, we would ask that you would complete the upper portion so that we might get to know you just a little better. We're glad to have you worshiping with us today. Dr. and Mrs. Negley are enjoying some vacation time. He will be back later in the week, and we have Presbytery on Thursday. And Dana Parrish, our director of youth ministries and our student ministries, and Pam Baker and Cherise Harris left yesterday morning with our high school youth group, and they were off to Montreat, North Carolina for a wonderful week. And we pray for their travel mercies, and we ask that they would have a wonderful time as they gather up there. Would call your attention to all of the announcements printed in the bulletin. There are a number of them. This is the third Sunday of the month, and on the third Sunday of the month, we receive a special offering to benefit those who are hungry in our area and beyond. It is our 3 cents a meal offering, and a portion of it stays here to assist our bag lunch ministry as well as our soup kitchen ministry. A penny goes to Bethel, which is located in Waimama, which is a migrant farm ministry. And then a penny goes to Honduras to help there feed the children who are hungry as they gather on Sunday mornings for worship and Sunday school. We provide them with a food called merienda. And they come and enjoy the food, getting fed physically as well as spiritually. At this time, I would invite our younger disciples to come forward and help me collect the 3 cents a meal hunger offering. We'll take a basket, and if you have an offering to give, just raise your hand, and they will come and collect it. Down for our story. Please come on down. Take front seat. Good morning. It's good to see you this morning. I'm asking you if you have listening ears. Do you have listening ears?
I do.
When you have listening ears, it means your ears are wide open and your mouth is closed. Your ears are wide open and your what is closed?
Mouth.
That's right. Well, today that's especially important because if you listen carefully, you may hear more than just me talking. I have a wonderful book to share with you today. It's called The Man with the Violin. And so it's going to be very important to listen. Okay. Dylan was someone who noticed things. His mom was someone who didn't. One Friday in January was a day like any other until music. The high notes soar to the ceiling, the low notes swoop to the floor. All the notes swirl and sweep around, the blur of people rushing here and rushing there. The music is telling an exciting story. It makes the hairs on the back of Dylan's neck tickle. Mom, wait. The man with the violin sways this way and that. His fingers move quickly. His bow dances across the strings. The skittering notes make Dylan want to dance too. Then the music slows, and the man's eyes close as if the music is carrying him from bustle, bustle, bustle to somewhere far, far away. Please, Mom, can't we stop? Please, if only they could listen for even a minute. Not today. The man with the violin leans forward. His music makes Dylan's skin hum. Someone begins shouting, blibbity, blibbity, blah, blah, blah. Dylan leans toward the musician, trying. All in comes the saddest sound he has ever heard. The man turns in his direction. Their eyes lock. Dylan's eyes and the man's eyes. But the escalator pulls Dylan down, 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 and away. Bursting out of the tunnel, a loud clattering, Dylan strains to hear the music, but rumble, rumble. The train gobbles up the faint notes with its roar. All day, the music Dylan heard that morning plays in his head.
Have you ever heard music before and then heard it play in your head all day? Well, that's exactly what happened to Dylan. It gets stuck in your head, that's right. On the way home, he says, "Mom, do you think maybe that man will still be there?" His mom says, "What man?" Rain patters, dishes clatter, a voice on the radio drones on and on until suddenly, music, telling a story that makes the apartment bigger and brighter, and Dylan shouts, "That's the man in the station." The music fades, the voice on the radio says, "Today over 1,000 people had the chance to hear one of the finest musicians in the world. Joshua Bell was playing some of the most elegant music ever written on one of the most valuable violins ever made, yet few people listened for even a minute." Dylan says, "I knew it. We should have stopped. We should have listened." Into a pot of bubbling water spills the spaghetti. Again, the musical story slips and slides through the air, and Dylan can almost see the man with the violin standing on tiptoes to reach the high notes. "Dylan, you're right." His mom turns up the radio. Loud and sweet, the music fills every corner of the apartment. And together, Dylan and his mom dance. Together, they listen. Dylan was a little child, but he persuaded his mother finally to stop and listen. They didn't stop in the train station, but they listened on the radio. And it was the same music that Joshua Bell had played in the train station. And Dylan had listened, but so many other people went by. This time, Dylan was able to get his mother to listen. Now, I want you to know that Joshua Bell is a real person. He was born December the 9th, 1967 in Bloomington, Indiana. And when he was 4 years old, he tried to make music like he heard on his parents' records by plucking rubber bands that he strung across the handles of dresser drawers. His parents signed him up for violin lessons right away. An early song he taught himself to play was the Sesame Street theme song. By the time he was 7, he played so well he got to perform with the Bloomington Symphony Orchestra and was taking lessons at Indiana University. At 12, he was very serious about his music, but he loved playing tennis and computer games too. Many musicians dream all their lives of playing at Carnegie Hall. Joshua Bell first played there when he was just 17. Then he went to Europe to give concerts in cities where people had already heard what a great violinist he was. Since then, he has given concerts all over the world. He has made over 40 CDs and has often appeared on television. His favorite TV appearance was on Sesame Street when he got to play Sing After Me with Telly Monster on tuba. Someone once said, "Joshua plays violin like a god." Now that is a very true story that you see. Joshua Bell did play in the train station. And there were so many people who were so busy and in such a big hurry that they didn't stop to listen, even for a minute, to the beautiful music you're hearing now. They didn't stop for even a minute. But in this story, Dylan did. And Dylan later got his mother to listen, stop and listen too. And she realized what she had missed that day. But Dylan had stopped and listen to the music. And that's what we have to do. We have to take time to stop and listen to the beautiful sounds we hear in our world, to see the beautiful sights in our world, and to realize that God has made them all, and God has given people like Joshua Bell special gifts to make music for us. And God has also given us some special gifts that we can make music to God as well by singing praises to Him and glorifying His name. Let us bow our heads, close our eyes, and let us pray. Dear God, we thank You for beautiful music, for beautiful music that draws us closer to You. We thank You for giving us talents and for people like Joshua Bell and so many others who are very talented who can make music for all of us to enjoy. Help us to have that childlike quality to listen, to appreciate all the beauty and wonder we see and hear in our world. Keep us always in Your loving care, for we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you so much for putting on your listening ears and enjoying that special story with me today. Thank you.
Our scripture lesson today comes to us from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 18, reading verses 1 through 5. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a child whom he put among them and said, "Truly, I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. This is the word of the Lord. From my observation of young children, I have determined that it is very easy to entertain them. When a parent puts her child in a swing and gives the child a push, the child squeals with delight. When a parent tosses his child into the air and then catches him or her, the child laughs. Because their children have responded in these ways, the parent repeats the actions to entertain their children for a while. Quickly, the child discovers that enjoyment is found in repetition. Later, as the child acquires a vocabulary, the word again gets quite a workout. The child has had a good time playing a game with her father, and she says, "Daddy, let's play it again." The mother reads a favorite bedtime story to her child, and he says, "Mommy, read it to me again." Yes, it is easy to entertain young children, and repetition plays a big part. As the child grows and develops, he or she may initiate the repetitive action, drawing the same picture again and again, playing make-believe as the same character or the same situation again and again, or watching a DVD or playing a video game again and again. Now, when I was young, we did not have cell phones, computers, DVDs, and video games. We did have a record player, and at a young age, I learned how to operate it. Walt Disney had released a film called Babes in Toyland, and I really enjoyed the film. My parents got me a soundtrack album. The only way for me to relive that experience then was by playing the album. And play it I did. No sooner did it end than that I operated the tone arm to begin playing all the songs once again. You may remember one of the songs that was one of my favorites. "Toyland, Toyland, little girl and boy land, while you dwell within it, you are ever happy then. Childhood's joy land, mystic merry toyland, once you pass its borders, you can never return again." Now imagine that you hear that somewhere between 3 and 5 times during a couple of hours at moderate volume. That is the sound you often heard emanating from the Harvey home. I drove my mother nearly crazy as I played that album, that song, over and over and over. To this day, she bristles whenever Babes in Toyland is mentioned and whenever the song Toyland is played. It is suggested that Toyland, also described as childhood's joyland, is a place where children dwell for a certain period of their lives. And once they pass its borders, the lyricist notes that they can never return again. It is implied that once the child has grown up so as to become an adult or a teenager who no longer enjoys toys, no longer plays, that he or she can never return to that land. The child has grown up to be a teenager or an adult. That land no longer enchants him. her, and so for him or her, there is no going back. Yet in today's scripture lesson from the Gospel of Matthew, we learn that Jesus says it is not only possible, but it is necessary to become childlike again in order to enter the kingdom of heaven. The young, ambitious disciples had a question nagging their brains, and so they asked Jesus, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" No doubt, they wanted to know the qualifications and the requirements needed to aspire to such a position in the hope that one of them might become the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And by asking the question, the disciples revealed that they did not have even a clue about the true nature of the kingdom of heaven. Well, Jesus sees a teachable moment for the disciples, and he seizes it. Jesus called a child, whom he put among them and said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." New Testament scholar N.T. Wright helps us to understand this story a little better. Wright writes, "It is significant that in some languages, including Greek, in which the New Testament is written, the words for child are mostly neither masculine or feminine, but neuter. The child wasn't a he or a she, but simply an it." The child in this story is an it in Greek, verse 2. But I have guessed, this is right, I have guessed in the translation that it was a girl. Not least because a girl would make with special clarity the point Jesus was wanting to get into the disciples' minds, that the weakest, most vulnerable, least significant human being you can think of is the clearest possible signpost to the kingdom of God and what it will be like. God's kingdom, the future when heaven rules on earth, won't be about the survival of the fittest. It won't be the result of some long evolutionary process in which the strongest, the fastest, the loudest, the angriest people get to the front ahead of everyone else. Before Jesus drew the young girl to himself and put her in the midst of the disciples, Jesus must have known that the disciples had already had some list in mind of qualifications that they thought would be most important to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Among the qualifications they most likely would have considered would have been faith, hope, military courage, perhaps, and success. And Wright adds again, Jesus tosses all of that out of the window and instead calls a little child shy, vulnerable, unsure of herself, but trusting and with clear eyes, ready to listen, to be loved, and to love, to learn and grow. And this is what true greatness is like, he says. Go and learn about it. Well, let's keep the list and expand a little upon it. Let's consider what we believe to be the best childlike qualities that indeed would also be qualities for greatness in the kingdom of heaven. As I think about young children, one quality that comes to mind is their sense of wonder. Whether looking at the earth, the seas, or the skies, there is so much beauty to behold in our world. A trip simply outside leads one to new and fascinating discoveries if we will only open our eyes and take the time to look, to see. From my earliest childhood, rainbows in the sky have captured my attention. Just this past week, driving home after work, I saw a huge, vibrant, arcing 180-degree rainbow, and I was transported back to my childhood to experience again the wonder of that sight. As young children, we have the power to forgive and forget. A classmate or friend slights us or offends us, and we typically forgive and forget. And that is great when we have that capacity as children. But by the time we reach our teenage years or have become adults, we may forgive the offenses and slights, but in all honesty, we must admit we find it somewhat difficult to forget them. We have gotten past the injury, but it is as if there is still a scar. We remember what he or she said or did, and how their actions or words hurt us. As young children, there is a readiness to listen, and fortunately, that appears before we learn how to talk. As we saw in The Man with the Violin, Dylan was ready to listen to the sweet and sad sounds coming from Joshua Bell's violin. His mother, like so many of the commuters that day, was in a big hurry and could not take a few moments or a few minutes even to listen. They did not recognize the street artist as virtuoso Joshua Bell playing his beautiful Stradivarius violin. Young children are also ready to be loved and to love. We know well how children respond to demonstrative signs of affection. We also see how they learn to be loving as they themselves have experienced love. 1 John 4:19 tells us, "We love because God first loved us." It is through parents, grandparents, foster or adoptive parents, or other relatives that most children experience love first. Being loved and then showing love in return. It is through this experience that they are able later to make friends and to show love to them. Young children are also ready to learn and to grow. They ask questions like, how? And why? They are eager to follow in mother or dad's footsteps, to follow the example their parents set, and to imitate their behavior. It is fascinating to see children learn and grow. But the three best childlike qualities that teens and adults need to recapture to become great in the kingdom of heaven are humility, dependence, and trust. Regarding the disciples' question, notice that they did not ask, what is needed to become great in the kingdom of heaven? What characteristics will great ones in the kingdom of heaven exhibit? First place is their greatest concern. The late symphony conductor Leonard Bernstein was once asked which instrument was the most difficult to play. He thought for a moment and then replied, "The second fiddle. I can get plenty of first violinists, but to find someone who can play second fiddle with enthusiasm, that's a problem. And if we have no second fiddle, we have no harmony." It is very clear that humility is needed to create harmony. And we must admit there is a lot of dissonance in our world, with only pockets of harmony here and there. It is evident in our world that all the peoples of the world have not yet learned how to get along, to play well with each other, and to share. The song says, "Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be." And before we point to others who need to change, we need to change ourselves, to be peacemakers ourselves, and to show that childlike quality of humility. The other two childlike qualities are related. Dependent is what young children are. They are not able to provide for themselves. Children do not think that they can live on their own and meet even the basic necessities of life. They are dependent upon their parents, guardians, adoptive or foster parents, or other relatives to meet their needs. And trusting is also what young children are. While young children are not able to meet their needs, they nevertheless trust that their parents, guardians, or other relatives will provide for them. Young children who have been so lovingly cared for in the past have no reason to doubt that their parents, guardians, or other relatives will continue to care for them and to meet their future needs. They trust. This dependence and trust are the pattern of Christians' attitude towards God. Now, granted, there are situations when children's dependence and trust have been shaken by those supposed to care for them, thus making it more difficult for them to see God as the ultimate one upon whom they can depend and trust. Hopefully, somewhere along the way, they can experience God's grace and mercy so that even when they have seen these human relationships fail, then they can learn that God is ever faithful and trustworthy. You see, in this passage, Jesus would have the disciples and us to know that becoming like a child again calls us to exhibit humility in our interactions with others. Jesus would have the disciples and us to know that becoming like a child again calls us to exhibit dependence and trust with respect to our relationship to God. These three childlike qualities, humility, dependence, and trust, will be our best preparation for life within the kingdom of heaven, and will serve us well in our life now and until then. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. At this time, we will have the opportunity to present our gifts to God if we have brought a gift. During the singing of our last hymn, the ushers will come forward and will pass the plates, and if you have a gift you would like to offer, then they will accept it.
Thank you.
excuse me, for the last two Sundays, I have been preaching and organizing the worship, and quite accidentally, the last two hymns have been to Christmas tunes, so we've experienced a little Christmas in July. Today's prayers of the people takes the form of a bidding prayer, and after I say, "We plead to you, O Lord," you are asked to respond, "Hear our prayers." Let us pray. Creator God, the mountains which you created have often called your people to come up to experience closer communion with you. The psalmist knew when he looked up to the hills from whence his help would come. His help, as does ours, comes from you, O Lord, who made heaven and earth. Jesus scaled a mountain to sit down and share with the people some of his finest teachings regarding how we should relate to and care for one another. We thank you that our high school youth have had the opportunity to go to Montreat for the youth conference. We pray for them and for our Director of Student Ministries, Dana Parrish, and their chaperones, Cherise Harris and Pam Baker. Watch over them and grant them your travel mercies as they return home after an exciting week. We plead to you, O Lord. Loving God, you have taught us to love one another as well as to be not hearers only, but doers of your word. We thank you that through our giving, we can make a difference in others' lives. Our gifts to the 3 cents a meal offering provides food for our neighbors who benefit from our bag lunch ministry and Saturday soup kitchen. This offering also ministers to the migrant farm workers at Bethel. Our brothers and sisters in Honduras have merienda to satisfy their physical hunger as they come to church on Sunday mornings to be spiritually fed as well. By supporting local missions, we participate in ministering to many different needs within our communities. Through our gifts to missionaries, we share the good news of Jesus Christ with people around the globe. We are grateful. We plead to you, O Lord. Constant companion, we lift up to you our prayers for all those who travel and are enjoying summer trips. We remember those who go for family or class reunions, for those who visit faraway places, seeing beautiful or historic places in this country or abroad, for those who retreat to the mountains or beaches for rest and relaxation. Protect them in their comings and goings. Renew their spirits. We plead to you, O Lord. O God, our refuge and strength, we lift up to you our prayers for those who have been caught in the path of fierce floods, torrential rains, destructive tornadoes, and devastating wildfires. We pray for those who have lost loved ones and those who have lost homes, livelihoods, possessions, and property. We plead to you, O Lord. God of great compassion, we are very familiar with the shortest verse of the Bible, Jesus wept. There he wept over the death of a dear friend. We know that you weep over man's inhumanity and how your tears must have flowed as a lone gunman assaulted and killed our military service personnel in Chattanooga, Tennessee. We join with people around our nation mourning this senseless violence, and we lament the terrorism that we experience in our own country. We commend to your care and protection all those who serve our country here and overseas. We plead to you, O Lord. Great physician, we pray for those who are in need of healing of body, mind, and spirit. Hear our prayers for Brian Howard, Nan Mason, Kim Hastings, Doug Council, Nancy Kramer, Dee Palmore, Cooper Hicks, Madison Rule, Bob McClue, Mel Miller, Jana Easterling, Hank Davis, Roger Abel, and Linus Mincy. We plead to you, O Lord. Holy Consoler, we remember all those who have sustained losses within their family circle and within their circle of friends. Hear our prayers for the Richard Precourt family. We plead to you, O Lord. Gracious and merciful God, we pray for those who are addicted, those who are depressed, those who are hungry, those who are homeless, those who are illiterate, those who are imprisoned, those who are lonely, those who experience turmoil in their family, those who are stressed financially, those who are troubled, and those who are unemployed. There are so many hurts. There is so much suffering, and so we plead to you, O Lord. All these prayers and the silent ones of our hearts we offer in Jesus' name, and together we pray as he taught, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and evermore. Amen.